Hi, I'm Roland Van Roy. In this video, I will present some practical methods how you can design, build, and test a complete DC-DC converter prototype in only a few hours. When making DC-DC converter prototypes, you cannot really make use of this perf board material because the connections will add a lot of stray inductance, which easily leads to malfunction in high-frequency switching circuits. I normally make use of double-sided bare copper PCB material, in which I cut some slots to form separate copper islands. You can then connect the components between the different copper islands. This method works quite well because the connections have very low inductance and resistance. You can also add traces at the bottom by drilling a hole and connecting a wire from top to bottom. Let me show you how to make this 5-volt 2-amp buck converter prototype. For the prototype example, we will use the following specifications. For a 12-volt input, I would use a 17 or 18-volt rated part. Output voltage lower than the input voltage means you need a step-down buck converter. The 2-amp continuous load current will determine the thermal condition, and a 3-amp peak means you need at least a 3-amp rated part. To achieve low power standby mode, you need a converter with high efficiency at light load. This means a part with PSM, discontinuous mode, at light load, to reduce the switch losses at light load. The last item is related to layout and thermal. In these applications, we will use the PCB copper for cooling the device. You need to check the power losses and the package thermal capabilities. In this example, I will choose a PSOP 8 package with exposed pad. It has a wide 1.27 mm pin pitch, which is easy for a handmade PCB. SMD PSOP 8 packages with exposed pad are cooled by connecting sufficient copper plane to the thermal pad. You can also connect vias under the thermal pad to other ground layers to increase cooling. Here are some practical values I normally use for different SMD package max power dissipation based on a good layout and 60 degrees maximum ambient temperature. The PSOP 8 package can dissipate around 0.9 watts. I will use the online design tool RichTech Designer to help me find a suitable part, calculate component values, and simulate the circuit performance. After entering input and output requirements in the quick menu, I will check the required boxes in the component selection page. SOP 8 package, discontinuous operation mode for low power standby. In this example, I choose a current mode part to illustrate some stability aspects, but you could also choose an ACOT part for faster load transient performance. The tool now shows the parts that match the selection criteria. For a good compromise between component size and power dissipation, I choose RT7257GH ZSP, which runs at 800 kHz and has hiccup mode protection. The tool generates the schematic with suitable component values. The tool calculates with the stated component values, so you must enter the values of the components that you are actually going to use. Current mode buck converter stability is related to output capacitance and compensation, so here you must use accurate values. MLCC capacitors have lower capacitance at higher DC voltage and small AC ripple. You can check this from Murata datasheets, which you can find in the BOM section of the online tool. I choose two 22 microfarad 10 volt 1206 size MLCC output capacitors. From the datasheet graphs, you can see that the effective capacitance of these types at 5V DC and low AC ripple is only around 10.3 microfarads. Since the tool originally used 2x22 microfarad, we now need to change the compensation for 2x10 microfarad output capacitance. To do this, reduce the compensation resistor in the same ratio as the output capacitance drop, so the original 32K will need to become 15K. For the inductor, I will use a low-cost Taiyoyuden NR8040 4.7 microhenry inductor, which has a 4.7 amp saturation current and 18 milliohm DC resistance, which is sufficient for this design. Note that these parts are semi-shielded. They use magnetic epoxy resin as shielding, but can still emit quite some stray field.
After entering all key component properties, we can now use the tool to simulate output ripple in light PSM load and high load, look at the step response and gain phase analysis, which shows good stability. We can also check the circuit efficiency and power loss. When making a DC-DC converter layout, you have to consider the current loops. There are two main current loops in a buck converter. The red current flows via the input capacitor, the high side switch, the inductor, to the output capacitor. The blue current flows through the synchronous rectifier, inductor, and the output capacitor. The total current in the inductor and the output capacitor is the sum of the two currents, which is continuous. This loop is not critical. But the current in the input capacitor and the two switches is discontinuous and therefore can generate a lot of EMI. When making a layout, the red loop area should be as small as possible with low inductance. The blue loop can be larger as it does not generate a lot of EMI. The switching node and bootstrap capacitor node have fast switching voltages. These traces should be minimized and kept away from other sensitive circuits. Non-shielded or semi-shielded inductors will emit considerable high-frequency magnetic field, which can induce switching voltages in nearby loops. Keep sensitive loops away from the inductor. In a double-layer board, I try to keep all high-current loops on topside. I start the layout by placing the input capacitor as close as possible to the IC V-in and ground pins. This will give the smallest input loop. The inductor is placed close to the switch node and minimize the switch node area. Remove the copper directly beneath the inductor to reduce eddy currents due to stray field. Output capacitors go from V-out back to the main IC ground. The bootstrap capacitor goes via a bottom trace back to the IC. Small signal components are placed away from the switching loops. Feedback network close to the feedback pin, V-out sensed near to the output capacitors. The comp network also close to the IC. The enable is connected via a resistor to V-in. The soft start capacitor is not really critical. The bottom ground plane should be connected with vias to the IC thermal pad. For the handmade PCB, I will use one thick via near the IC ground and thermal pad.
Here you see some of the tools you will need to make your own PCB for DC-DC converters. This is an engraving tool that runs at very high speed, and you can fit many different types of bits. Here I'm using an engraving bit with a very fine tip, but you can also use these kind of diamond burr bits for cutting away material. You will also need some thin drill bits for drilling holes in the PCB, normally around 0.5 to 0.6 millimeter. And in order to punch a dent in the PCB for your drill guide, you need a steel pin with a very sharp point.
To cut pieces of PCB, you score the board a couple of times on each side. Then you can easily break it on the edge of the table. Start the layout by drawing the IC pin grid on the PCB. ICs with pin pitch down to about 0.6 mm are quite doable. Then place the components on their intended locations. Then you can draw the components' outlines on the board. Now it's time to draw the copper islands. I normally draw square islands, which are easier to cut. Finally, clean the drawing with an eraser. You can now cut thin slots to form the copper islands. Use a high speed setting and use low pressure, a bit like sketching. use a multimeter to check for shorts, especially at the corners. Remove copper under the coil with a diamond burr bit. Then sand and clean the board. Place back the components and mark the holes for the vias. Use the punch tool to make the dents for the drill guide. You can now drill the 0.6 mm holes for the via wires. On the back side, you can now use the holes to draw the bottom traces. And then cut the slots to form the traces. Check for shorts again, sand and clean the board. First we solder the IC thermal pad to the PCB. Then solder the IC pins. Now we can mount the inductor. Then place and solder the components at one side. Then solder all components at both sides. Before mounting the via wires, first add some solder at the PCB bottom edges. Then mount the via wires and solder them at top side and bottom side. Then add some connection wires for the input and the output and ground. And add a short loop measuring spring on the output capacitor. Forgot one item. We need to add the thick via from IC ground to bottom ground plane. I use a 0.9 mm copper wire for this. I highly recommend adding a 220 microfarad electrolytic capacitor at the input to avoid resonances and hot plug spikes due to the long input wires. It's time for testing. I use a 100 ohm variable power resistor as load. Connect the output voltage probe and set the scope bandwidth at 20 MHz. I also measure the switching waveform. We start up with 100 ohm load. You can see that the converter operates in PSM mode. When increasing the load, you can see that the converter goes to PWM fixed frequency mode. In PWM mode, the output ripple does not really look like the simulated waveform, and its amplitude changes when you move the probe. This is because the measuring point is very close to the inductor. Its stray magnetic field still couples into the small measuring loop. To get cleaner waveforms, you can place the output capacitors further away from the inductor. Now the output ripple is close to the simulated value, both in PWM and PSM mode. But in PSM mode, we see that the converter sometimes shows double pulsing when changing the input voltage. PSM mode regulates on the output ripple valley. It is quite sensitive to noise. In our layout, the feedback network is grounded at topside copper. But this ground is noisy because the switching currents also flow in the topside copper. It is better to ground the feedback network to the bottom ground plane, which provides a clean ground back to the IC ground. You can do this by isolating the small signal ground from top ground and placing a via to bottom ground. After this change, you now see that the PSM mode is stable, and the PSM to PWM transition is also much cleaner. Let's have a detailed look at the switching waveform. You should connect the probe with short leads directly between the IC switch node and ground. Measure at the highest load and high bandwidth setting. You see that the switch node looks quite clean. The overshoot at the rising edge is only 3 volts. It is related to the input loop. The undershoot at the falling edge is related to the IC low side MOSFET parasitic inductances, basically caused by the IC bonding wires and lead frame. Let's see what happens when you place the input capacitor further away from the IC. With this location, the input loop is much bigger. you now see that the input rising edge overshoot is huge, around 10 volts. This is caused by the extra inductance of the input loop. You should always try to place the input capacitor as close as possible between the ICV in and ground. Let's do a converter stability check. I will use the Richtek fast load transient tool for this. Adjust the static load to 2 amps and add a 1 amp load step by selecting the 4.7 ohm pulse load resistor. You can see that the step load is clean without ringing. Over and undershoot values are similar to the simulated results. Just to illustrate what you would see if you had not made changes to the compensation, we changed the compensation resistor back from 15K to 32K. You now see that the step load response shows ringing, which indicates too low phase margin. Always check the effective capacitance when designing DC-DC converters with MLCC output capacitors. In the last test, I will check the converter power loss and thermal conditions. To measure the temperature with an infrared scanner, you cannot measure the shiny PCB surface directly. I normally add some correction fluid at the PCB measuring points to increase the emissivity of the surface. After 1 hour operation at 2 amps load, I measure the input and output power and the IC top and PCB temperatures. From the input and output power, you can now calculate the converter power loss, which mainly consists of inductor losses and IC losses. The inductor losses are DCR loss and AC core losses, which can be estimated from the simulation tools of the inductor vendors. The IC losses for this application are around 0.85 watts. Here you see the various temperatures I measured on the board. The temperature drop between two points depends on the thermal resistance and the heat flow between those points. You can see that the single via transfers considerable heat to the PCB bottom side. Since most IC heat is removed via the thermal pad, there is not much heat removed via the plastic package top. So the junction temperature will be close to the measured plastic top temperature. I estimate around 4 degrees higher. From the IC junction temperature, the ambient temperature, and the IC power dissipation, you can estimate the total board thermal resistance from junction to ambient, which in this case is around 67 Kelvin per watt. At 120 degrees C junction, the IC power dissipation will be around 0.9 watts due to the increase of RDS on at higher temperature. This will give a temperature delta of around 60 Kelvin between junction and ambient. So for this board, the maximum ambient temperature to keep the junction below 120 degrees C will be around 60 degrees C.
I hope you found this video interesting. Making your own prototypes can be a great way to find problems at an early stage, and you can easily make changes before going to a final layout. Please stay tuned for more tutorial videos at Richtek, your power partner.